From coast to coast, live via satellite, it's time to praise the Lord! Major Christian events in America and across the world, covering over 500 million souls with the good news of new life in Jesus Christ. Now from Southern California, we invite you to be a part of the world's largest prayer and praise gathering. Lord, our dynamic evangelist, author of over 250 books, and gifted teacher, Dr. C.M. Ward. Renowned crusade evangelist and television co-host, Dr. Jack and Rexella Van Envy. Ministry of music, gifted from your heart, girls, Janet Pascal. And ready to take your calls, some of the most beautiful prayer partners in the world.
Welcome. Hello, everybody. Come on in. It's time to praise the Lord. And do we have much to praise Him for? Are you ready for this? Hello, Rapid City, South Dakota. Channel 33 signed on the air actually a few days ago, and they didn't even tell me. Hello, Rapid City. Many, many fond memories. I was telling Dr. Whitaker on Behind the Scenes today, who joined me, that that's where our number one son was born in 1959, yes. Boy, will Paul Jr. be 30 years old this year? Dear Jesus, help me. And he was in March. Yes, mercy, where have I been? And that's where I had my first little job in a radio station, KRSD. Harry and Eli Daniels were the owners. And Channel 7 NBC signed on the air just shortly after I took that job to support myself so we could be the assistant pastors of First Assembly of God there in Rapid City. I love the Black Hills. I think in the millennium maybe the Lord will let me go back and live at least part-time there, maybe before. I love the Black Hills, and I love that beautiful section of the world, and I don't know, my mind just kind of was flooded with happy memories, wonderful memories. Our first few days, months together as man and wife, and our first baby was born there. And do you have anything to add to all of this rhetorical?
Well, I was watching you on Behind the Scenes as you were talking about how you literally ran a television station, one man operation. And for those that don't get Behind the Scenes, I thought that was just really cute. We did get Channel 7 NBC affiliate while we worked for Mr. Daniels. I didn't work for him officially, but of course, wherever you were, I was always there. And he loved you. You were assistant pastor over at the First Assembly there.
Well, Eli could cuss like a sailor, but he would always kind of respect me and our faith and our love for the Lord.
You'd had to have been totally deaf to not hear him cursing throughout the building. But at least he wouldn't do it when you were in the room. But it was, he was a precious man otherwise, just a wonderful man. And we just literally began pioneering. Nobody knew what to do. I mean, nobody knew how to do TV 30 years ago. And tell them how you used to run the late show.
I was the last man at the station. I had to sign the station off, and I had to run the late movie and the last wagon train and all of the late night primetime programs. Well, the budget was very limited, and I was having fun with the crew here this afternoon. I said, if we have to, we can always go back to this. I would literally, now, before the Lord, I would literally stop the late movie, run like heck, around, turn on the cameras, run out in front of the cameras, do the cottage cheese commercial or whatever, and then run back as fast as I could and start the movie up again. I wish we could have had a videotape of some of the... Second thought, I'm kind of glad we don't. I'm sure it would have really been bad.
And the very first newscast on Channel 7 in NBC there in Rapid City, where we just signed on there, you did it. I went and bought newspapers, sat down on meat paper, and wrote the news out, and I was your teleprompter. And you literally read the news, the first one.
Forgive us for doing a little reminiscing tonight. It kind of all flooded back as the joy of knowing that Channel 33, Rapid City, South Dakota, signed on the air. And if anybody's watching up there tonight, please give us a call tonight, will you? And give us a picture report and let us know how the signal is coming in.
You know, when you mentioned that today, you were saying we work for Channel 7. Television and radio. You also carried a radio shift where you played songs. Then we worked at the church all weekends. But you forgot I also worked for a dentist. We held down three jobs while we were there. I worked for Dr. John Tobin there, a dentist, and I'm sure he's still practicing right there. And he was a wonderful man. He was 6'8", weighed 325 pounds. And he was a dentist, and I, when the little children would come in, I would have to meet them, you know, because I'm only 5'5", and I don't scare them. And I would meet the children, and then Dr. Tobin would be in sitting at the chair, and I would bring them in so that his height didn't scare the children. But it was a wonderful time.
It really was. Busy, happy times as we were starting our life together. And I will not tell you about the time she tried to do impressions of my teeth.
I did do impressions.
You nearly killed me is what you did. I don't want to talk about that tonight.
Hilarious.
Anyhow, we have a wonderful program this evening. And, can somebody get a tight close-up here real quick? Hold all of my other papers here, will you please, and the microphone. It's time to give you a little progress report. I did it on behind the scenes, but all of you don't get behind the scenes. This is the old grocery store we bought up in Portland, Oregon. And our people have been up there working on it. And there it is. It needs a lot of tender, loving care. But we're going to get busy and work on it. Somebody, can the crane operator move so I can see the... There we go. This is the big... footings that they're pouring for the tower reinforcement. The men are working just as fast as they can to get everything put together. And let's see, I think I have one more picture to show you. Yeah, there it is. What happened to my other picture of the front of the building? Well, anyhow, we're working as fast as we can. Those of you who are watching on cable up there, I know I'm not happy with the progress either, but it would take me the rest of the program to tell you how you old you-know-who has been fighting us to keep Channel 24 off the air there. So keep praying. We finally got the building permit to get the transmitter building underway up on the mountain. And now we've purchased the old grocery store. It's being remodeled, complete new partitions and everything put inside. And give me, oh, Jesus help me, 6 months. 6 months to 7 months, and we will have Channel 24 on the air 24 hours a day, lifting up Jesus all over that great Portland, Oregon area. So keep remembering us in prayer. Okay, shall we sing a song and have a word of prayer? Let's just agree. Brother Ward is back tonight. Oh, how we've prayed that the Lord would touch his body. He came very close to death. And he'll tell us a little bit about that tonight. But the Lord has had mercy upon him and upon us and has spared his life. Oh, how I prayed, Lord, we need Brother Ward. We need his great heart. We need his mind. We need his teaching. We need his wisdom. And the Lord has heard our prayers. And we praise God that Brother C.M. Ward is here with us tonight. Still a little on the weak side, but that mind, I'll tell you, there's nothing wrong with that mind. It's still as sharp as the tack. And what a joy to have. And then always a joy to have Jack and Roxella Van Impe here tonight, great preachers and teachers of the Word. Get your Bibles out. I have a feeling we'll have a good Bible study before Brother Van Impe leaves tonight. And then, let me see, our singer tonight is Janet Paschal. And she's got a couple of good songs that are going to bless us. Let's just agree that the Holy Spirit will come now. Join hands there in our little studio audience, there at home. Jesus said, if any two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that you shall ask, it shall be done for you of my Father in heaven. We're agreeing with you right now. And if you're there alone, stretch your hand just up toward heaven, and he'll take your hand, and we'll still agree with you. Father, in Jesus' name, we just agree together tonight that the glory of the living Christ shall enter this room and each one of us, and then explode out through these airwaves to needy, hurting, crying, dying people. Oh, Spirit of the living God, let every word find good soil tonight, and may it spring up unto life eternal, we pray. Lord, just let every song and every word of testimony and every scripture and everything we say be to the praise and the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. Use us together tonight to touch the hearts of the lost, of those who are grieving, those who are sick and afflicted. Lord, let your healing virtue even now begin to flow as we agree together in that name that is above every name, the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Amen. All right. Janet Paschal's going to get us underway musically tonight. Let's put our hands together. Come on, do it right now as she sings.
Celebrate Jesus' name. Put our Have you ever been hungry when Jesus wouldn't feed you? Have you ever really needed him when it seemed like he just didn't need you? Or have you ever seen someone who was down? Didn't seem to care about. David said, I've never seen the righteous forsaken. I've never seen the righteous forsaken. No, I've never seen the righteous forsaken. Oh, God's seed are begging for bread. Now you may feel down today, but look up, your help is on. Ever just passed you by when you needed a savior? Or has he ever one time just ignored your cry when you ask him for a favor? Has my Lord ever once turned his back on you? No, when you need the Lord, he'll see you through. I've never seen the righteous forsaken, or God's seed a begging. He's gonna bless you twice. I know I've had his blessings for all my life. I've never seen the righteous forsaken, or God's seed are begging for bread. Now you may feel down today, but look up, your help is on the way. Dark clouds may dim your skies, but he will answer you by and by. By and by. If you make one step,
Janet Pascoe, bless her heart. Always a joy to have Janet. Of course, many of you already know Janet. You've been blessed by her singing on Jimmy Swaggart's program. She's now out in full-time ministry and singing on her own. Her latest record album, Come Morning, has reached the gospel charts across the nation. And did you know this? That she was actually voted queen of gospel music for 1979 and 1980. So we'll have some more good singing tonight from Janet. By the way, Cherry Frame just called me from Rapid City, South Dakota. Coming in good. Great. Thank you. Now, Cherry, you've got a big job to do. I only got one call. Okay. So please spread the word up there through all of Rapid City that Channel 33 is on the air.
And Spearfish.
Spearfish is just north of Rapid City, right. Yes. Hello, Brother Ward. He doesn't need an introduction, does he? Let's just say it's good to have Brother C.M. Ward
good
back.
Good to see you. Hi, honey.
He's been through pretty deep waters here, and we'll find out a little bit about that.
But well, I too have memories of Rapid City.
Yes.
I can tell you the hotel where the station was located, the Johnson Hotel.
Yes, downtown Rapid City.
And on Main Street, I continued with tent meetings after quite a camp meeting.
I told you the brain was all right.
No.
He remembers the hotel.
And we had cards printed, show cards for display and advertisement. And when I distributed them in the tent that night, it was a keepsake. The card man printed or painted, "Come hear the ward party."
The ward party?
Yes. "Preach, sing, and dance."
Dance?
Dance.
Had you ordered that?
No, he'd grown accustomed to show business. And he thought of us, when the order was given, as another entertainment unit.
I see.
And that's what he did on the card.
I see. Do you still have one of those?
Have one.
That will go in the CM Ward Library.
Yes. "Come hear the ward party. Sing, play, and dance." It was quite a shock to the audience.
I see.
But we had, I had my own band.
Sure.
Richard Orchard, who has pastored there for years.
Oh, yes.
The great accordionist.
I've seen
musical vans. And Dorothy, a great saxophonist. Mm-hmm. I began as a pianist, like Swaggart.
Mm-hmm. I see.
So
did you sing any?
It's a beautiful location.
It is.
Beautiful location.
Yes, I love the Black Hills.
Oh, I can go there every year, like Hong Kong.
Mm-hmm.
It is a center.
Yes, sir.
And the National Park Service must be congratulated. They keep it beautiful.
Yes. Everyone should go see Mount Rushmore.
Yes.
Sometime in their life.
Yes.
That great
And now
sculpture.
As they prepare another great stone attraction,
What's that?
Oh, they're going to present that great Indian chief.
Oh, the crazy horse.
Yes.
Sculpture.
Yes.
Oh, is that about to be finished?
It should be, because they've worked on it for years.
I know. Well, we've got to get back to Rapid City. We'll have a rally up in Rapid City maybe next year after folks get the word that we're on the air. Brother Ward is back with us after quite a serious bout with, I guess you had pneumonia, didn't you?
Deadly.
Yeah. Tell us a little bit about it.
Well, Paul, probably there must be a moment where each believer, whether an Elijah or a Philip, reaches a point of confusion.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there isn't a better Bible teacher and preacher than Van Impe, our co-host tonight.
Mm-hmm.
And I listen with respect and reverence and believe, not mm-hmm. quite as strongly as Dorothy. Dorothy believes everything she sees on TBN.
Really? Your wife?
Yes.
I love her.
So I wanted to practice what I preached.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I had warning signs, especially a wheeze at night in bed that said there's something wrong with your lungs.
Mm-hmm.
But you told me that Jesus heals instantly.
Yes, sir.
And that he takes authority over Satan. And I believed it.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to Mississippi. See?
Believing.
Yes, down into rebel Confederate country.
Yes, sir.
Do you know that Jackson was one time called Chimneyville?
Really?
The Union burned it 3 times in order to cut off a rear action as they moved toward Vicksburg.
Hmm.
But it's a great city today.
Mm-hmm.
So I preached, I claimed the promises as best I knew how. See, I stood on everything but the bath towel. And nothing worked. See?
Really?
I said, Van Impe is right. All of this great stable of success must be right. I must be wrong. I'm going to be healed. I will be healed.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're healed.
And I struggled until I ran out of gas. I had nothing left. And let me tell you, honey, I couldn't find anybody that had any more faith than I had.
In all of Mississippi.
I had hands laid unto me until my head ached. I had more devils cast out of me than mother used to cast out with castor oil. And I shall never forget that last night. I was in room 1001 in the Ramada Inn, Jackson. Half undressed, coughing into Kleenex and newspaper. Mm. I felt death. I smelled death. Mm. I spoke with death.
Jesus.
And finally, in that misery, trying to do a little packing, and I was all through with religious services. And I had a ball game turned on to keep me from going unconscious.
Oh, what does this do to our theology tonight?
Yeah.
There's got to be an answer here somewhere.
You better have the answer.
Now, let me say, a wonderful pastor who's been there 27 years and wonderful RNs wanted to rush me immediately to the hospital. But that would have been, you know, Z in the alphabet.
Yeah, yeah.
So, Jan, I don't know whether God in his humor or pity. I got down to the point of begging. See? I don't know whether that's a form of prayer or not, but I said, God, I'm begging for one little favor. Let me get home.
Yeah.
Let me get home. Yeah. So I thank a wonderful pastor in Jackson, his staff, the American Airlines. I know I shouldn't differentiate,
it's okay.
But they had chairs for me. Now, I shouldn't say this, but it will help some other pastor. Dorothy and I are members of a certain church in San Jose. Mm-hmm. This is the seventh week of my illness and long recovery. And that pastor has not even made me a phone call. Mm-hmm. Now, what are pastors doing today? Mm-hmm. I don't object to their gulf for their deep sea fishing. I certainly don't object to their study and their counseling. I don't think we are the poorest of the members of that church. We may not be among the elegant, but we have contributed. Mm-hmm. Now, if he is going to treat me like that, is there much hope for the flock?
Where are they?
We need shepherds.
Where are the Edgar Bethanys?
That's it.
Yeah.
Just a phone call. Mm-hmm. But God is in mercy. And through your kindnesses, people have reached me from everywhere, sympathetically.
Well, I know a lot of prayer has been going up, Brother
Ward. You know, Springfield twice announced my death in recent years.
Really?
Oh, yes. The first time... the phone was choked. It really blew out their circuits in Springfield.
You mean really? Mistakenly
really?
They
yes,
announced
really.
Your death?
Really. Where can we send flowers?
Oh, really?
What are the details? How is Dorothy taking it? You know. And when they learn, like Mark Twain said, that it had been grossly exaggerated, I didn't even get a potted geranium.
Really?
It's remarkable how people love you in the casket.
When you're alive, they like you at all. That's
what funny. What is the lesson we need to learn from all of this, Brother Ward? Give your flowers while they can still
smell
them?
That's the old, old line, and it needs to be... And I'll tell you, now all of us, for the last decade, have emphasized the power of Jesus.
Yes, sir.
And we have forgotten the beauty of Jesus. Mm-hmm. Let the beauty of Jesus be seen in me. Mm-hmm. See, we've forgotten that. That message is in the cupboard. It's in the refrigerator waiting. It's a leftover. Mm-hmm. The character of a Christian. See, mm-hmm. We've forgotten that side. We now are all bristling pugilists, willing to take on what Saint Michael wouldn't take on, say.
But where's the cup of chicken soup when...
Where is the character of Jesus? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I've had to check this in my own life. Mm. See, let the beauty of Jesus be seen in me. Mm-hmm. And we need a revival. We need a revival. It's interesting, Paul, as you read the Acts, almost on every page where it says great power was upon them, a few verses later you'll find great grace was upon them.
Yes.
Power without grace leads you to brutality. It leads you to a Castro image, you see. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Stir up the gift of God that is within thee. He hath not given us the spirit of fear. Ah! Thank God for that boldness. Thank God for that faith. Thank God for reaching toward new zeniths, buildings, congregations, songs.
TV stations.
Ah, but it has to be balanced with love and a sound mind, see.
Good.
Because if you just have love, then you become sentimental, wishy-washy. But you have to have intelligence as well. So it's a balanced life, and we need, as we minister, to keep a balance before the audience.
All right, I've got a question.
Yeah, please.
There have been several times in my life when I was attacked physically, and I stood on the Word, I confessed the Word, and in hours, maybe minutes, I felt the healing virtue of Jesus, and I have been instantaneously healed.
Well, glory
I know
to God.
He does it.
Yes.
I know He does it.
Yes.
But I went
bucked on
early. Well, forget the horse. I'm going to go back to to January.
Yeah, don't blame the horse.
I'm tired horse, of talking about that
the horse. The
horse
wasn't under ordination.
No. That was just a spirit of foolishness on my part.
Well, but, I started with that too. Yeah. But I thought it was faith.
Okay, we may be getting to something here. Early this year, about January, I started coming down with one of those awful, I don't know if it was the swine flu or bad stuff, man. Yes. I mean, I was coughing.
Satanic.
It, absolutely. And I said, no, I'm going to South Africa anyway. So I got on the airplane and I flew 27 hours, got worse and worse. I will say this, I kept all my appointments, I did everything I said I was going to do, but man, I came home sick as a dog.
And you felt that was victory.
Well, in a way
I
it was.
I did too.
In a way it was, but why does
but
God...
But there is a boundary between presumption and faith. Now, that is demonstrated between Saul and David. Saul could never wait for God. He was always ahead of God. Mm-hmm. That's why David, his son-in-law, repeats it almost on every page. Again, he will say, wait on the Lord.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
See?
Mm-hmm.
I remember an instance in Louisville. I was with our recently departed great friend.
Who?
Early in his career.
Oh, you know. Pastor Wayman Rogers.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And I was told in this campaign that half of the Louisville Baptist Seminary had come to hear me preach. And it was a transfusion of pride. Baptists coming to hear a charismatic.
Yes, yes.
I did pray for the anointing. Thank God. No, I wasn't at fault. I did pray for the message. But there came a point in that message where the Spirit of God told me to quit.
Really?
And begin an invitation. But I was only on my first point.
Ah.
And I did not want to disappoint the Baptists who had come to hear a renowned preacher. And would begin with an outline and points.
Yes.
I ruined that service. Shortly after the Baptists left, babies began to cry. Women who could no longer resist the restroom began a parade. See? I preached beyond. I was presumptuous. I got ahead of God. I stood in front of God. Mm-hmm. I wanted the focus to be on me.
Mm-hmm.
So, one of those great enemies, the world, the flesh, and Satan. The flesh constantly is an enemy. Probably my greatest enemy. C.M. Ward gets in the road.
We have to battle that right on up to the end of life, don't we?
Yes. They cannot be reconciled.
I thought we finally got over that hump and...
I wish. I've been sanctified by the Pentecostal holiness. I have been helped by the Christian Missionary Alliance. I married a Nazarene. I have had the prayers of the Van Impies.
Mine too.
And that C.M. Ward, that carnal person is still there in this house. Thank God one day I'm going to shed the house.
Yes.
Yes.
Because you cannot have the final redemptive man or woman in these quarters.
Okay. Where did I miss it? Where did you miss it? Why didn't the Lord heal you and me immediately when we asked him to?
Why didn't he heal every leper in Israel? Was Bartimaeus more worthy than the other blind?
No.
Was Zacchaeus more worthy? Now, that gets to the character of God. He's not a Santa Claus. He's a Heavenly Father.
But he does heal me immediately sometimes. But not
in
time.
South Africa.
No.
See, and why did he not heal you there?
I don't know.
Well, I did a great sermon many, many years ago, so it can be pardoned. I have no chip on the shoulder. When I was broadcasting for the Assemblies of God called Sick.
Sick. You see,
Paul left a member of his party, Mr. T, Trophimus, or however you wish.
Mm-hmm.
Sick. It says so in the Catholic Bible and in the Gideon Bible.
Mm-hmm.
And heavens to Betsy, the executive said, you cannot preach that sermon because it will destroy faith.
Mm.
See?
Really?
So we eventually build a Disneyland, a fantasy. See?
Mm-hmm.
Step in, it's like the old piano slogan. they were stunned when I sat down. But they laughed when I couldn't get up.
Yeah.
See.
Yeah.
But God makes the final decision. And he evidently had another lesson for me to learn.
Well, I think one of the lessons is that you can't continually burn the candle at both ends.
Yes. You cannot blow the gaskets. When I was Van Impe's glorious age, I felt I knew I had eternal life.
Yes.
Now, I know I don't.
Well, this,
now, I don't
want to.
Yes. I don't want to confuse recent converts. The inner man is strong.
Yes.
But we have this inner man in what?
This house of clay.
A house of clay. And Paul, who had a remarkable physique, see, next to Jesus, beaten three times, stoned. He knew the inside of every respectable jail from Rome to Jerusalem. Shipwrecked in the deep.
Yes.
Hungered, thirsted. Huh? How did he manage those years of evangelism? One thing, he carried a biographer and best doctor in Israel with him, yes. Dr. Luke.
Yes, sir.
And I'm sure Dr. Luke would say after one of Paul's great sermons, Reverend, come on in here. You need a good hot bath and a rub down. But we presume on God. We will exhaust our bodies, which, and Paul calls it, it's one of those things you skip. He says, my vile body.
Yes.
Now, Miss America would disagree with Paul, see. She looks at her chassis and says, I've got $250,000 worth of assets. Paul looked at his. Nearsighted, bald-headed, scarred, bow-legged, hot-bellied. The Corinthians made fun of him. They said, he's powerful in message, but he is ridiculous compared to Apollos, that Greek. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels. And it's remarkable what this earthen vessel can do. But there are times when we say to it in the name of Jehovah, do more. And it rebels. Just like Balaam's mule.
Yeah.
See, Balaam wanted the mule to do what the mule couldn't do by structure. But
so,
that doesn't deny there are times when God allows this vehicle to perform, like David with that target, see? He would have won the gold medal in Olympics. He had a little target in that giant's forehead. 9 out of 10 times you'd missed it by an inch or so. See? You find a sharp shooter that scores 1,000.
So what are we trying to say to that little person out there that has also had all hands laid on them, that has fasted and prayed, stood on the word, and even the bath towel, as you say?
What well, I know Jan is in her good years. You're a little frosty.
Yes.
But in the early days of the assemblies, one of the singers was McKinney out of Akron. He sang at every big meeting because he could whirl on a stool and not miss a beat like a trap drummer flipping a stick. And the layman's songs were the great songs of those days. See, 50 miles of elbow room, so on. And there was a great song that I and members of my party sang, Get Alone Somewhere with God. It's fine to listen to the ministry of any platform, but we need to get alone somewhere with God and ask God, Thy will be done.
Yes. See? Yes.
And unless His will is done, His power and His government are not done.
Amen. Amen. Well, we've all learned a few lessons tonight. I know what the answer is in my case. You just don't violate the natural laws of God and just continually get...
He'll
bail you out a few times, maybe, but you finally have to learn that lesson.
The last little bit I leaned toward in that night when I was sitting there, He maketh me to lie down. I surrendered and I said, while I'm coughing, burning, thinking and checking my will, see, what will Crouch say at the service? Will Jan laugh when she looks at me in that nice couch? I said, God, I'm not going to resist Your will. You are making me to lie down, so I'm going to lie down as fast as American Airlines can take me.
Well, we praise God that He had mercy upon you, and He heard our prayers, and though it may not have been as fast a healing as we would have preferred.
I would like to, you know, to romp onto that platform and say, who doesn't?
Sure.
I like to have my picture taken, and I like to have the story in Van Impey's magazine. And I like to have an audience go berserk. Who doesn't?
Of course.
See?
Yeah.
But God doesn't always accommodate us.
No.
See?
No.
Now that takes you back to another great saint, Santa Claus. Every year.
Saint?
Yes. He has a line like Oral Roberts used to have.
See? Santa Claus.
And he sits like Oral Roberts sat for years.
Yes, I think I am.
And a little citizen will come. And Santa will go through just a very brief, have you been a reasonably good boy or girl? Mm-hmm. Do you have a point of contact? I work best on the chimney. Now, Oral and I are the best of friends, you know that. Yes. And I usually come after dark. That's when to expect. Close your eyes because if you peek, my chariot knows when you peek. Now, a little redhead fella is coming up through the line. And Santa's ready to interview him. And the redhead kicks him on the shin.
Mm.
And he says, that's for what you didn't bring me last year.
There we all are.
There we are. There we all are, yes.
Paul, his ways are above our ways.
Yes.
And his thoughts above our thoughts. For as high as the heaven is above the earth.
Yeah.
And God is merciful, but in the wear and tear of our ministries, we often forget the truth that we have learned and been taught, and we have to return to it.
The old song sums it up, trust and obey.
Yeah, there's no other way.
To be happy in Jesus, but to trust and obey.
His way is the best way.
We've got another whole subject we want to cover with Brother Ward tonight.
Oh, boy.
Get your prayer requests in, and we'll have a time of prayer together with you in a little bit. Can we tell them a little of the progress on the C.M. Ward
Library? Oh, I think so. Sure, sure.
Brother Ward and I just a couple hours ago before the program began, we're across the street. Did you know the C.M. Ward building is very, well, it's not nearing completion, but it's coming along very well.
I've just received a great honor from the Air Force.
What is that?
One outstanding chaplain. I think you may know him. He's a full colonel now. Sent me a beautiful plaque from the Air Force. It humbles me. He says, the ministry of myself and so many chaplains who've been under my command goes back to your teaching and your preaching and your help to me as a young minister.
Praise God.
Now, he's a command chaplain.
Well, now, that beautiful award is exactly some of the
You're
beautiful
You're going to have it in your library.
Your library, and it's going to be right across the street from Studio C here. We're so excited. A lot of Brother Ward's books and papers and memorabilia will be there. We're going to make, Jan's going to make a beautiful lounge, lobby lounge. It'll look just like a five-star hotel. And it'll be a place for you, the partners, and ministers to come, and we'll have
I will come for a few days at a time, and during the day teach young ministers and ministers.
Oh, that would be wonderful.
So that they can have a digest seminar, but pick up new thoughts and new revelation and insight into the Word of God.
Hey, some of you ministers that might be viewing out there, would you like to do just that? Would you like to come here, have a pastor, minister seminar, and have Brother Ward share some of the great years of wisdom that he has with us? I think it'd be wonderful. And I mean, when I say library, I mean a real library. We're going to have the little stepladder and the whole wall, the whole building filled with books. I want every sermon you've ever preached in books to be in that library. And pastors and evangelists will want to come and use it as a reference room and library. And Brother Ward, I still am claiming that you'll be here for the rapture and that we won't have to give you up till Jesus comes and we all go up. But if the Lord should call you home, the legacy that you will leave to us, should he tarry, will go on and on and on.
That's
and
right.
I promise you one thing, as long as Jan and I are alive, that will be a place of preaching, teaching, instruction, and we will make provisions in the ongoing testament of Trinity Broadcasting, if we should even go on, that it will be there till Jesus comes.
Remember that I, too, owe a great deal to both your families. Your parents were pioneers, and Jan's parents were the ecclesia. Edgar Bethany made me always feel like a beginner, his knowledge of the Word.
He was special.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. I got finished with a funny little story. I think you were present. After Dad moved into other ministries and left the great church at Columbus, Georgia, our friend Cy Homer came. You remember Cy?
Yes, very well.
A giant.
Yes.
And I was in a great convention there, and as many do when it came time to preach, ministers leave the platform so they can see me and hear me and check me. So suddenly I looked down and said, Cy, how many books are there in the Old Testament? Now, he was a college president, a great speaker, pastor of Edgar Bethany's great church. And he volunteered 41. I shall never forget the disaster that hit Ruth and the noise that spread and grew. This outstanding pastor and genius did not know how many books there were in the Old Testament.
How many are there?
39.
39, yes.
There are 66. 27 in the New, 39 in the Old. 3 times 9 is 27. So if you're on Jeopardy, you can remember.
3 times 9 is 20. Yes, I got that.
Yes.
I think I would have passed
now,
that. 39, yes.
The book of Revelation is open to interpretation. Your interpretation. Our dear lady friend, one of the nice, good teachers every afternoon.
Marilyn Hickey.
Dorothy listened to Sister Hickey.
Yes.
And she's been moving through the Revelation.
Yes.
But I believe the most powerful 66, most powerful, is that Bible. See, every attack is toward that book.
Mm-hmm.
And 6 is the number of man.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
One short of perfection. Mm-hmm. And 666 simply is a picture of that last great antagonist that will seek to replace the Word of God with his own book.
Can we take a few minutes in a minute to
get
into
some music.
The church in Israel?
Yes, and while you were hearing about this, if someone would replace this water, it's the only criticism I have of Trinity.
Really?
That you have 3 and 4 day old water.
Really?
Yes.
Oh.
Remember, Jesus said a cup of cold water gets a reward. Any other kind of water does not get a reward.
Would someone please get Dr. Ward a cup of cold water?
Yeah.
That can easily be remedied. Now, Jan. You told me that in Dr. Graham's book on angels that you had an answer for Brother Ward and all
sure
of us.
I'm sure I do now.
You know, I stand on the word and go to South Africa and come home sick. And then, because I've abused my body and haven't taken proper rest and relaxation, I go and I take a little time off and I ride a horse and get bucked off and nearly break my neck. So is there an answer in Brother
I think all of us know the answer to what he's going to say. I want Stacy to come get him some fresh water while I'm reading. Bless you.
Thank you.
You're sweet. Get him a couple of glasses.
Yes, and we want people to know that we don't drink anything here but water.
And a little coffee from time to time.
Well, we're praying about that.
Yes, I see.
But the other day, we picked up another one of these fabulous books on angels by Billy Graham. I was reading this several years ago over in Phoenix at my mom's house the night that Arthur Blessett needed the miracle down in Nicaragua. And we prayed angels. After I'd read this book, we prayed angels just go and fight for him. And so we know the story. He literally saw hand-to-hand combat going on with 12 big angels came to fight for him and save his life as he was there in Nicaragua needing a miracle. Well, I picked the book up the other day and was just reading it again to my little daughter-in-law, Lori. We were on the plane and I was reading it to her and she began to be blessed and so did I. We wonder sometimes what this massive battle is that we go through. We give Jesus our lives and our heart and we give him our all and all of a sudden seems like all hell breaks loose. Well, that's exactly what's happening, just exactly. And Dr. Graham just makes it so clear in his book. I'm not going to be able to read it verbatim because the chapter that I want to read is about Lucifer and how he comes to just constantly attack children of God
and
harass and anyway, I'll just read little portions of it. We're going to try to get this book to give it away to all of our partners, but let me just read a little. The Bible refers to Lucifer and the fallen angels as those who sin and did not keep their first position, Jude 6. They committed the sins of consummate pride and covetousness. The sin of pride particularly has caused the downfall of many men. If pride could bring about the downfall of Lucifer in heaven, most certainly it can bring mortal man down too. We must be on our guard, and then he goes and talks about things like that. But says we live in a battlefield, just perpetual battlefield. The great war of the ages continues to rage. The lines of battle press in even more tightly about God's own people. The wars among nations on earth are merely popgun affairs compared to the fierceness of battle in the spiritual unseen world. This invisible spiritual conflict is waged around us unceasingly and unremittingly. This battle of the enemy, where the Lord works, Satan's forces hinder. Where angels are being brought to carry out their divine directives, the devils rage. All this comes because the powers of darkness press their counterattack to recapture the ground held for the glory of God. Were it not for the angel hosts empowered by God to resist the demons of Satan, who could ever hope to press through the battlefields of the fiendish demons of darkness to the Lord of eternal liberty and salvation? Paul speaks the truth when he says that the forts of darkness are impregnable, yet they yield to the warfare of faith and light.
Amen.
As angel hosts press the warfare to gain the victory for us. Let me just read another little point. Isaiah 13 clearly points up Satan's objectives. He works to bring down the downfall of nations, to corrupt moral standards, and to waste human resources. Corrupting society's order, he wants to prevent the attainment of order and to shake the kingdom of God. He uses his destructive power to create havoc, fire, flood, earthquakes, storms, pestilence, disease, and the devastation of people and nations. The description of Satan's great power ends in the words, "Who opened not the house of his prisoners," Isaiah 13:17.
Mm-hmm.
This undoubtedly refers to the prison house of Satan, Hades and the abode. And it just goes on to talk about, honey, so many things. And Satan's attacks, which began at the dawn of history, will continue until God begins to bring down the curtain on this frightening drama.
I've always been amazed at Blessing's strength. He's gone through jungles. He's exposed himself on every continent.
Arthur Blessed.
Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And it leads us to a line in the Pentateuch. As your days are, so your strength. I believe there's a principle there, Paul. It is like people who fear death and they want dying grace. Well, what they need while they're alive is living grace.
Mm-hmm.
Dying grace will be given at the point needed.
Mm-hmm.
So, Blessing in the will of God, doing an outstanding bit of world evangelism, is provided strength that would not be provided to me because I do not need to do what he's doing.
Sure.
Now, I learned that from our early missionaries. See, they had little or no modern help. And they went into deadly Liberia and other places, breathing malaria.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I remember Johnson, you knew him. He always called himself my twin.
Mm-hmm.
And he would tell you in the first term, living in a grass national hut, earth floor, primary. His wife pregnant, about to give birth. She entered and a cobra fell right down on her shoulder to the earth floor.
Mm.
Well, she aborted that child. There were no hospitals within hundreds of miles. No possibility of getting home. Yet God gave that woman strength to live into her late 70s. Mm-hmm. Now, I would presume both to move into that situation and demand strength to match it, because it isn't the will of God for my life. Mm-hmm. So many times we ask for equipment and talent and support that God denies because they aren't suited to the task that God selects for us. Mm-hmm. And in the book, you know, I love Billy, and he and I have been good friends. But you need to read Grady's book, his most intimate friend, mm-hmm. because Billy had a sickness worse than Paul or mine. Mm-hmm. And Grady deals with it in a couple of chapters, mm-hmm. in which dear Billy simply finally got home more unconscious than conscious. Mm-hmm. So there are many strings to the instrument, Paul.
Well, the bottom line is the old song we used to sing, remember, the fight is on, O Christian soldiers, and face to face in stern array.
Yeah.
It is a fight, isn't it? It's a struggle, and it's going to be, you know, I keep wishing and hoping that we get over that hump, and but I'm wishing for the millennium, aren't I, really?
Yes, really.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. We got you a cup of cold water.
Oh, fine. Thank yes. you. I didn't see it arrive.
It is quite cold. Oh, thank the Lord. And you will not lose
thank
your reward,
God.
Stacy.
That's the best I've had at Trinity.
We must work on the water
the
around
water
here,
duty.
Dear.
The water duty. Yes, we will. Here's so many calling from Rapid City and just...
Oh, really? More yes. from Rapid City.
Praising the Lord. Honey, here's a very serious little request that we need to get in right now. A boy, has been hit on a bicycle.
Oh.
And they're rushing him in
oh,
for surgery right now. And they're going to have to do brain surgery. A little Denzel, little boy. And I don't know what town, but we need to pray right
Amen.
Now.
Amen.
Here's asking for prayer for mental illness in the family. Needs a miracle. Mm. Here's someone concerned about Arthur Blessed, wondering how he is, and he's just going to be fine. He's out of the hospital, and he's just going to be fine. They really don't know what it was, some tropical fever or something, they really don't know. But he's going to be fine. Here's someone with cancer of the bladder, honey. Mm. And so many had it hit by a car, another one. Here's a little mother is expecting a baby and has begun bleeding and is asking for prayer.
Okay, hold all of these. Let's get all of those that are on the phone right now, and let's have Janet Paschal sing another song. That'll give you a few more moments to get in your prayer requests, and then Brother Ward and Jan and I are going to agree with you for the touch, the healing
yes.
touch of Jesus in your body. Remember one thing, sickness does not come from God. He didn't put you on your back so you could look up. Sickness and all of these troubles come from the devil. And you need to get that firmly fixed in your mind and realize that it is a battle, it is a warfare, and sometimes we bring on ourselves things that, you know...
We've created a few sicknesses ourselves.
Exactly.
I'm no friend of Lucifer, but in all fairness...
Do it ourselves.
He has had a lot of help from the flesh.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes,
yes. I don't think he created AIDS. I don't think he's smart enough to do that. I think smart human beings created that terrible last mm-hmm. day leprosy.
Yeah, mm-hmm. well.
Yeah, you know, I hope we won't be sued, But Satan isn't responsible for Miller Beer or Budweiser.
No.
See?
No.
Or dice or the roulette wheel. These are the creations of decadent man. He's in the religious business. He has always been and always will be in the religious business. So when you deal with the adversary, you don't deal with him in the dance hall or the pool hall. You deal with him within the circumference of religion. He's yes. an angel of light.
Yes.
See?
The scribes and the Pharisees
he
still live.
He has synagogues. He has doctrines of devils.
Yes.
He has the entire equipment.
Yeah.
Yeah, he runs the religious system of this world.
Well,
and sometimes, I got to add this little P.S., sometimes I fall from grace. Now, I don't mean I sin, but I leave the tenets of faith that I know, and I drop into religion. I drop into Assemblies of God religion, which is a beautiful package, handsome package, but cannot raise the dead or heal the sick or cure my cough.
It's a system.
Yeah, but it has a beautiful convention with gavel and all of that.
And that's not to say there aren't wonderful
saints
of God.
Oh, no, I need religion.
In that.
I need religion like I need the market.
Mm-hmm.
But it's ineffectual in dealing with the great struggle in the unseen.
Well said.
See?
All I know is Jesus said, I have come to destroy the works of the devil.
Yes.
And we're going to agree with Jesus in that. Let's sing a song first. We want a little time so that you all can get your final prayer requests in, and then Brother Ward and all of us are going to agree together with you right now. Janet Paschal is going to bless you as you call Heaven's Jubilee. Make those calls and prayer requests now.
Savior in the skies.
Thank you, Janet. Share, honey, some of the final prayer needs. Just so many are calling in, Brother Ward, to say, welcome back. Prayed for you, thanking God that He spared you and is giving you your health back again.
You want to hear the salvations tonight? Douglas from Whittier, 39. Christine, 30. Here's Gertrude from Fresno, 68. John from Norwalk, 36. Connie from Minneapolis, Minnesota, 22 years old. Just received Jesus. Brian, Maddie from Bryan, Texas. And David from Pomona has just received Jesus.
And I'm getting all kinds of calls from Rapid City, South Dakota. Margaret just called
loud and clear.
Barney and Gail Madler from Rapid City. And here's Charlotte from Rapid City, loud and clear. God bless you. We're glad to be on Channel 33. Help me spread the word. All right, let's pray. Many, many urgent needs have come in, and we want to just agree together with you. And then when we've had prayer, Roxella Van Impe is going to bless you all with a great number and song. And Jack is here also. Yeah. And we're going to get into some terrific teaching on Bible prophecy, I'm sure. Brother Ward, lead us as we agree now for these many
Father, weeks. I join with Paul and Jan, my servants. It is a law where two or three are gathered.
Amen.
But unless thou art with us, the two or three are not the magic number.
Oh, yes, Lord.
But we believe because we sense thy presence. There is not the presence of a world system here.
Amen.
We have been lifting Jesus, talking about his company, talking about his gospel. Help us to be conduits to these who are looking toward us.
Amen. Yes.
And we would be faithful as under shepherds to lift them to the great shepherd.
Amen.
Who presents them to the Heavenly Father, whose omnipotence is the final word. Bless, we pray thee, and respond to the faith. These who have telephoned, have taken that first step, bless them. And let them know that they have not called in vain.
Amen.
We ask in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And everybody said, Amen. Well, Brother Ward, time flies when you're having a good time. At least whet our appetite a little bit for that other little subject that we'll get into on your next visit, the church and Israel.
Well, we get back to the common error. I know I was alerted to it when I began study. How easy it is to substitute the church for Israel or Israel for the church. I think the greatest speaker I've ever heard in life, not the greatest believer, but the greatest speaker, was Bishop Sheen.
Fulton Sheen, yes.
And Bishop Sheen said in his direct and picturesque way to those of that day that were talking about a separate generation, look at your belly button.
Yeah.
I cannot deny the past. The church does reflect Israel, and Israel is important to the church, but they are separate economies.
Mm-hmm.
Israel lived under the law, and that is why Israel will govern in the next 1,000 years,
mm-hmm.
because it is to be law and order.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly the believer could not govern because he can't even govern his local assembly. So we'll get into that
mm-hmm.
the next visit.
All right.
And may I add to this?
Yes, sir.
You know, their similarity is the pattern. Israel began with a dirty dozen.
Yes.
Jacob and his macho men. And the church began with a dirty dozen. Peter and all the unlearned and ignorant.
Mm-hmm.
That the glory might be of God.
Yes.
So there's a lot to investigate, and especially as we move toward the next 1,000 years.
Yes. Ooh, fascinating study. Let's tell the Lord and Brother Ward we're glad he's well and back with us and gaining strength every day, and we really praise God for it. Jack Van Impe is here and his lovely wife, Roxella, and she's going to sing you a pretty song right now.
Rexella.
Rexella. I am sorry. From Royal Oak, Michigan. I will give them a proper introduction in just a little bit. Let's tell Rexella, we're glad she's here tonight. She's going to sing a beautiful song of praise. Praise the Lord, he never changes. Welcome, Rexella. Beautiful. Thank you, Rexella. Come on down and join us, and let me introduce two wonderful people that Brother Ward has already introduced somewhat tonight, hasn't he? What a guy. What
got
a
into
guy.
My magazine and everything.
Yeah. Jack and Rexella Van Empty, you're beginning to enjoy their program right here on the Trinity Broadcasting Network, Wednesdays at 6:30 in the evening's California time. Jack is an evangelist, has conducted more fundamentalist-sponsored citywide crusades than any evangelist in the 20th century. How many songs did you say you and Rexella have sung together over the years?
90,000.
90?
We did 15,000 services, and we did six numbers a night.
Oh, that's a lot of, yeah, how's the vocal cords? Still working, isn't it?
Wonderful.
Amazing.
He played the accordion.
This is a little out of date. It says you held 1,070 full-length through. It's more than that, you say.
15,000 services.
1,070 full-length crusades,
a lot of one
crusades,
night.
With maybe a whole week or 10 days or 2 weeks or whatever. Jack has also aired 19 one-hour primetime specials on the networks and other TV stations. Has been on weekly television now for the past 6 years. Seems like longer than that.
Well, we were on for about 5-6 years and then took a sabbatical for 2 years and returned.
Mm-hmm. Also a very prolific author. My goodness, Israel's Final Holocaust.
You know, Paul, you moved more of those books than any man has ever moved in history.
Really?
Yeah.
That
was a bestseller. No, that was, you pushed this about 5-6 years ago.
Exactly.
And you moved a couple hundred thousand of those.
Yeah, a lot of them. It's still...
Would you like to push all my books?
Very current and up to date. Well, I'm sure there'll be a lot of folks that'll be interested in other books. Revelation Revealed.
Verse by verse. That's
yes. If you want a serious study of the book of Revelation, Jan's got dibs on that one, she said. There it is. They call him the Walking Bible. Jack has a marvelous, I wish I had some of that gift, the retention, the memory. I don't know how you do it, but you can quote almost the whole Bible from memory, can't you?
I'm at the 10,000 mark, and I've decided to stay there because it a lot of work to review everything as well as
10,000
verses.
Mm-hmm. 10,000.
How many are there?
Are there 30? In the Bible?
There's 7,800 in the New Testament, and then I've taken most of the evangelistic texts out of the Old Testament.
You literally can quote a good half of the Bible then from pure memory.
Quite a bit.
They call him the Walking Bible, friends. Very, very understandable. Sin's Explosion, Alcohol, the Beloved Enemy. And 1159 and counting, and I see this has a 1983 copyright. And
I have a new prophecy index coming out in 1 month from now. Everything from A through Z. You just look it up like a dictionary.
Interesting.
Prophecy manual.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome, Jack.
Good to be
here. Rexella.
Good to have you all back.
Thank you.
You've been listening in on Dr. Ward, and we...
I think he was reordained as a Baptist.
got into a little Baptist doctrine, and now you're going to give me, you say, some charismatic doctrine. Where did we miss it? Any thoughts as to...
Tell them about Belgium?
Yes.
You know, I wouldn't have missed that for the world.
He was
Brother
hilarious.
Ward, he's really special.
Let me just say this, Rex, before you get into that. When I was a teenager, though I was Baptist, I came out of paganism. My father was an atheist. We were in nightclubs. We were converted. And the first man I heard was Dr. C.M. Ward. And he motivated and stirred me because he puts emphasis on certain words, as he did tonight. Mm-hmm. And so he was my hero down through the years. And I think the thing that blessed me the most is 6 months ago, receiving a letter from his wife, who said, "You don't know what a blessing you are to me." Mm-hmm. I mean, my hero's wife writing me, telling me what a blessing the ministry was.
She watches you on TBN, I'm sure.
Yes.
Right.
Yes, she does.
Yes.
What was your
What's
story?
What's this little story?
I couldn't help but smile when he was talking, you know, about his illness and so forth. And then, Jan, when you brought about angels, because when we were in Belgium, this goes back 7 years ago, we had a terrible, terrible accident. I was almost killed.
Really?
I landed in the street downtown Brussels, And a bus took off the right side of our little foreign car, and I was out. I was dying, literally dying, and I knew I was dying. And I had a, what some people I guess would call an out-of-body experience, whereby I actually knew that I was leaving my body and I was going home to be with the Lord. And I just want to say this to everybody who's listening. If you're a born-again believer, there's nothing to fear in death. I had the sweetest peace that I've ever had. I know I will have it again when I really do die, go home to be with the Lord. But I remember looking back, and I saw Jack leaning over my body, praying for me. And I remember saying to myself, you know, I'm going home to be with the Lord. The sweetest peace. Oh, I love this, but I hate to leave him. Mm-hmm. And I was revived with his tears on my face and the blood all on my face and my eyes. And I found myself coming to back in my body, coming to, and an image there. And we now believe it was my guardian angel. You mm-hmm. talk about angels, Jan, yeah. that came to assure us that I was going to live.
You saw this image, or Jack saw it, or both?
We both did.
Really?
And, you know,
what was
people might say, well, what's happened to the Van Impeys? They become fanatical, but it's the word of God. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Hebrews 13:1. And are not the angels ministering spirits sent forth to minister to them who shall be the heirs of salvation, Hebrews 1:14. It's there, mm-hmm. but I as a Baptist and many of our Baptist brethren don't want to believe what Hebrews 13:1 and Hebrews 1:14
says. Boy, Billy Graham sure does.
Yes.
He's a Baptist.
Exactly.
Yes.
Fabulous.
But when we talk about mm-hmm. the miraculous and talk about these things, we want to dispensationalize it away. That was mm-hmm. for another era. It's not for today, see? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But I don't believe that.
What did this angel form look like?
I was looking through bloody eyes, really. My eyes were filled with blood. It's wonderful. I was home 6 months recuperating from this. I was all broken up.
I didn't know this.
The only thing that wasn't broken was really my face. God preserved my face.
The picture of the automobile, and, I'll be turning to it while you're talking.
All right,
here.
Honey. And what he said, I heard heard this voice in perfect English, downtown Brussels, where they speak nothing but French, say, she's going to be all right. And put a blanket on me.
Oh, my
and with this, Jack sort of leaned forward and he said, honey, I believe that you're going to be all right now. And I believe that the Lord just especially sent that angel to assure us.
Okay, you know what my problem is right here?
Look at the car.
Okay, so because of your angel, no doubt your life was spared.
Yes.
But couldn't that angel have just prevented the accident altogether so that you didn't have to go through that suffering and the broken bones?
That's true. I believe that. But I believe what Brother Ward was saying a moment ago, God's plan for my life. He taught me so many things in that 6 months when I was home recuperating. In fact, that was just prior to our going on weekly television.
You know, I just thought of something. You know, the angel of the Lord tried to come with a message to Daniel, but was prevented by stronger demonic angels.
The Prince
of
Persia.
He was prevented for 21 days. Maybe in Brussels, Belgium, where you are, my goodness, we know that's the seat of evil over in that area. Maybe there were stronger demonic angels knowing there and prevented her angel from protecting her for a while. Mm-hmm. I don't know the answer to all
that. Jan, I really believe that the devil tried to take my
life.
Well,
I'm sure.
I really
in
believe that.
In that area.
And that God said, no, it's not time yet.
Yeah.
I'm going to leave her there to serve me for a while yet. Mm-hmm. And then we went on weekly TV. I never missed, even though I was in a cast. 4 weeks later, I was on television with Jack. Uh-huh. Never missed one time. Just like you, Paul, in Africa.
Yeah, I've seen his angel.
Yes. Jan has literally
seen. We named him Joshua.
Really? Is that
on several occasions, particularly when we fly
I was so afraid for him to fly in a little plane. We'd always just gone commercial, and Ken Copeland gave us a plane.
Wonderful.
And I was so afraid for him to fly in it because I was afraid of them. And the first time I ever got in it to fly, I was just sitting there, just all afraid, you know, and strapped in and just waiting, you know, to feel like I was on a roller coaster. I didn't know what I was going to feel. And all of a sudden, I heard the engine start up. And I just looked out the window, and it frightened me at first because there was someone sitting on the wing. And I looked, and when I looked, he winked and went like this.
Jen, isn't that
And
precious?
I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that it was an angel. Mm-hmm. And he was there to protect us. And as the engine started up, I turned to tell Paul, honey, your angel is on. And when I looked back, I could no longer see it. But the Lord lifted the veil from my eyes just for a moment to see that angel that protects us. He's protecting
and
us.
You and saw so him on a number of other occasions.
I've seen him on other occasions, just for a moment, that same one.
That's precious.
He's
yeah,
there.
Yeah, that is precious.
How do you explain that?
The Lord goes out of his way. You know, that I praised him so often for that. He went out of his way. You know, he didn't have to allow my angel to appear. He could have just saved my life. But he wanted to bless us, assure us I was going to be all right.
Let you know. Yes.
You know, and let us know. And I've praised him so often for that, and I've shared with Jack what a special blessing it was to me that he would do that for me.
You know where I kind of come out on this that kind of gives me comfort, and I know you all may not relate to this or not, but it's simply this. If God just immediately put an absolute iron wall around us so that we never had any more trouble, any more heartache, any more accident, any more bucking off the horse, any more flu, any more anything.
That's right.
Where would the fight be? Where would the struggle? Where would the warfare be? And everybody would then want to be a Christian just to get out of the fight.
Exactly.
But we have to remember that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord, Romans 8:28. And in Romans 5:2-3, Paul says the tribulation works patience. We can't have patience without the tribulation. And no one had more of it than Paul. If folks will just read 1 Corinthians 4 and 2 Corinthians 4 and 2 Corinthians 11:23, he said, five times received I 40 stripes, save one. Thrice was I beaten with rods. Once was I stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck. A night and a day I've been in the deep, in journeys often, in perils of waters, in perils by my own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, etc. And so the angel of God didn't keep him from these things, but it happened so that his faith might develop, and tribulation does work patience.
Mm-hmm. You know,
plus the rewards. There'll be no rewards if we don't suffer.
Yeah.
Blessed is the man that endures testing, for when he's tried, he shall receive a crown, James 1:12.
Okay, I understand that, and even, you know, on the other end of the theological spectrum where we have, you know, the so-called faith preachers and teachers, that would be Kenneth Hagin, Kenneth Copeland, Fred Price, and others. And I believe they've brought a truth and an emphasis that I've tested it. I have put God's word to the test. I've stood on the word, and I've had instantaneous healings. Mm-hmm. I really have. So, you know, the gainsayers have reached me too late to tell me that God doesn't heal when we take the initiative and stand on the word and confess the word and speak the word.
That's happened with Roxella, healing. When this accident happened, the physicians told her she'd never use her arm again, and they wanted to have her in for surgery. And I believe in doctors, just like Dr. C.M. Ward said that Paul had Luke with him, the beloved physician. But I said, give us 2 weeks. And James says in the 5th chapter, let him anoint with oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick. And I touched Rexella's forehead with that oil, and she used her arm.
Yeah.
Okay, I understand that. I believe it. But it seems like there's a teaching over here that says, yes, Paul could suffer shipwreck. Yes, he could suffer beatings. Yes, he could suffer persecution. He could suffer all of these things, and we too can. Because I asked one time in a program, I said, well, if a Christian is never supposed to be sick, then how are we supposed to suffer? And it's like there's a teaching over here that says, well, the sufferings that we suffer for Jesus' sake are these other things, but not sickness. In other words, we really shouldn't ever, if we're really in the will of God, if we're walking in the light as He is in the light, if we confess the Word, if we stand, we can live in a perpetual covenant of divine health. Now, I will allow as how that dimension is there, but I have not yet entered into it, and a few have. I declare, Dad Hagen hasn't taken an aspirin for 50 years and hasn't had a headache by his own testimony. So I know that dimension is there. I guess it's the entering into it that I haven't been able to accomplish.
The problem is, in 2 Corinthians 12:7, Paul said, "For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me." And apparently that was ophthalmia, an eye disease. And the Lord said, "No, I'm not going to heal you. My grace is sufficient for you."
Of course,
Paul says,
"I'll
never pray about it again, for when I am weak physically, I'm strong spiritually."
But of course, your faith teachers will never admit that that was a physical problem, because then that would cause a little problem to the theology there. But
That's the problem. It caused problem to that theology, but not to the Word of God.
I meant that.
Right. You know, Paul, I will just want to say this. God has healed me several times, and I think that's how Satan has attacked me more often physically. Tried to stop my ministry with Jack. I've only missed 8 weeks we've been married 36 years. Only missed 8 weeks with him. And so I've had the victory in the Lord. But there was something I asked the Lord for, and He didn't give it to me, and that was a baby. I wanted a child more than anything. You know, Jan, the mother's heart. I had ladies coming to me in our crusades and saying, "Why don't you have a baby? Don't you like children?" You know, they questioned me. "Well, what is it?" And if they'd only known how many times I had begged God in tears for a baby. Now, I knew when I got on my knees that God would give me a baby if I would keep begging. You know, like the lady at the door just kept begging. He finally gave her what she asked for. Yes. But I could never get up until I said, "Lord, but more than a baby, I want Your will." And it was not God's plan for my life.
And someday when we get to heaven, I think He's going to give us instant replay, and we'll get to look back and see why these things happened to us. What really happened? I think you're going to get to see your angel step in there just in the nick of time and stop the plot and the plan of the devil from killing you. We're going to get to see all of this, I think. And then we'll say, I think, "Oh, Lord, now I understand. If I'd have had a child, it might have..." Who knows?
Absolutely. You know?
And so we have to... You're right. We have to finally say, "Lord, not my will, but Thy will."
And mean it, Paul.
And mean it.
You know, I used to say it, but there was a time when I really meant it, and God took me at my word. Now, I will never forget praying one night, though, all alone. Jack and I have never missed devotions together, but you know the sweetest times you have when you're alone with the Lord. I was alone. And I knew that if I persevered, God would give me a baby. But I couldn't, because in the spirit, I knew that that was not what God wanted me to ask for. So finally, that night, I really said, "Lord, Your will, not mine." And He took me at my word, and He's given us a lot of spiritual children. Perhaps I would not have had a part in that, you know, had I had a family.
What's this charismatic theology you were going to give me a little after getting through with Dr. Ward's Baptist theology?
Well, we were talking about the angels.
Oh, okay.
About the angels.
Okay.
The only trouble with this covenant idea is it is appointed that a man wants to die, and it'll either be through sickness or accident. So at the end, one gets out of the will of God if that's...
Well, let me tell you what the faith teachers would say to that. They would say, you don't really have to die either sick or by an accident. Right. You can just, like the patriarchs of old, leaning on your staff.
His grandma did.
Grandmother Crouch.
She sat down in a rocking
chair.
She
told my Aunt Mary, "I'm going to go home today." And she didn't have a sick day of her life. She sat down in her little rocker and went home. And just went on home, rocked right on home. And so surely there is
a higher dimension or a higher plane.
But even then, the wages of sin is death, Romans 6:23. That's why we die.
But I'm redeemed from the curse of the law by the blood of the Lamb.
It's still, though, the wages of sin is death. That's why we die.
Yes, right. That last enemy that shall be destroyed is right. Death, Paul
but
says.
But yet do we die. I just heard Charles Stanley preach
another good Baptist.
Most fabulous sermon on crossing over I have ever heard. We need to replay that.
Dr. Stanley is just one of the greatest preachers in the whole wide world, and he made
death wonderful.
Attractive, you know, I mean, absent from this body, present with this. Well, Roxella, you saw it. Yeah. Made it, didn't you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Really. And I just want to say that death is not, it doesn't hurt. You know, a lot of people think, oh, this is going to be horrible. But to me, I know that I'm going to have that kind of peace again when he takes me. And it is a blessed experience, an experience we don't need to fear. It's a peace I cannot verbalize. And the whole experience is one that now I can look at and say, I'm not afraid of it.
This has always been a blessing to my heart, where Paul is stoned in Acts 14:19, and there came thither certain Jews from Antioch and Iconium who persuaded the people, and having stoned Paul, supposed he had been dead. Howbeit, as the disciples stood round about him, he rose up and came with them into the city. All right? That was in...
He was tough.
That was written in 46 A.D.
Yes, sir.
2 Corinthians 12 was written in 60 A.D. From 46 to 60 is 14 years. Listen to Paul now in 2 Corinthians 12, too. I knew a man in Christ above 14 years ago. Whether in the body I cannot tell, or whether out of the body I cannot tell, God knoweth. Such an one caught up to the third heaven. And I knew such a man. He sure did, but he didn't want to seem like
man.
He had a big ego nature. Yeah. I knew such a man. Whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell, how that he was caught up into paradise and heard unspeakable things which it's not lawful for a man to utter. Because that was Paul's experience while he was stoned. He said, I don't know if I was dead and God brought me back to life like Lazarus, or whether I was unconscious and I came out of the coma. I do know I was in the third heaven. I saw paradise. Because of it, he could say in 1 Corinthians 2:9, I hath not seen nor ear heard, neither entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him.
And he could have never told us that if he hadn't gone through terrible experience of being beaten and having that out of the body experience. Mm-hmm. All things really do work together for good,
exactly.
Don't they? Maybe I'll learn that one of these days. Jack, there's so many other things that we want to get into. Anytime I get around you, I always want to say, give us a prophecy pulse. What's happening out there in the world today? Mainland China is changing dramatically. Russia is changing dramatically. The world is changing.
Israel?
Can you give us a little state of the world and where we are?
I said my program last week that I never preached the coming war with communism according to the Bible, but 35 years ago I began preaching the coming war with Russia according to the Bible. Mm-hmm. That's Ezekiel 38, Magog, Meshach, Tubal, Rosh. Can it be easily proven that this is Russia?
Yes.
The original name, of course, was Magog, or Meshach, then changed to Masach, then to Muscatine, then to Muscovy, then to Moscow. Tubal is southwest of Siberia presently on the map. And the Bible teaches that Rosh is going to march against Israel in the latter years and the latter days, Ezekiel 38, verses 8 and 16. China is going to be there, whether she comes independently or with Russia. She's going to be there because tidings out of the east and out of the north, China and Russia shall trouble him, the Antichrist who sits in the temple in Jerusalem, 2 Thessalonians 2:4. The sixth angel poured out his vial upon the great river Euphrates, and the waters there were dried up so that the way of the kings of the east might be prepared, Revelation 16:12. It's all coming together. And then, of course, three things happened in 1948. And we talk about a generation probably being around 40 years. First of all, we had Israel becoming a nation. Secondly, we had the beginning of the World Council of Churches. Mm-hmm. Met there in Holland that year. Thirdly, we had the beginning of the 10 toes of Daniel's image forming.
How's
as
that?
Benelux, Belgium,
yes.
Holland, and Luxembourg became the first three.
Yes.
And then we had France, Italy, West Germany, Denmark, then Ireland, England, and then in January 1981, we said, praise God, this is it. Greece has become number 10. Mm-hmm. But then people were perplexed when
Spain
and Portugal entered. They mm-hmm. said, now they're more than 10. Why? Well, very simple. Daniel 7:24, the 10 horns are 10 kings that shall arise. That's not all. And there shall arise another, number 11. He shall be diverse from the first 10, and he shall subdue three. The Bible teaches there really must be 13, because three will be thrown out, some of the original three.
Aren't there 13
when Antichrist,
right now?
12.
Oh, 12
so
in right
So one more,
now.
And out of the final three, this super dictator will arise and eliminate three of the originals to bring it back to 10, and this is exciting. I mean, this will make a Baptist out of you. Daniel 2:44 says, in the days of these 10, the final 10, after the Ben 10, number 11 arises, Daniel 7, verse 8 and verse 24. Number 12 and 13, one of the final three will arise, cast out three of the originals. 13 minus 3 brings them back down to 10. And in the days of these 10 shall the God of heaven set up his kingdom. Daniel 2:44. I tell you, I wish I could have heard Dr. C.M. Ward on this theory about Israel.
Yeah,
because
in the church.
How
close, Jack, do you think we are to it? I've heard many different thoughts and opinions, but...
You wanted to get me to a date last time I was here.
No dates, but I'll tell you what I'm fishing for. I want to know how many years I got left to build a TV station. It'd make a big difference on whether I do this or that. I guess I need to pray that through for myself, don't I?
Well, the Bible says, occupy till I come. So we have to just keep working at it as though it's never going to happen. Mm-hmm. And we need to do all we can because... we must reach them, and when that last one is reached that completes the bride of Christ, we'll be whisked away in the twinkling of an eye. 1 Corinthians 15:51 to 54, when he says, come up hither, Revelation 4:1, it's really near.
Yeah, it's funny that you're asking him that, because on the plane coming here today, I asked him that very question. I said, I was reading, by the way, Jen, you're going to want the book that I have called Destined for the Throne. Absolutely marvelous.
By Dr. Bill Hamer.
Oh, yes.
Our
yes.
building across the street is named after him.
Really?
Paul Bill Hamer.
Oh, it's
Mom and Dad spent their final years right here at TBN.
Oh.
Teaching, mm-hmm. preaching,
it's
blessing us.
It's the most fabulous book ever written.
Mm-hmm. I'm enjoying it. I just got it, and it's blessing me already.
We would try to read one. We would try to read two chapters at night when we first got. One is all we could take in.
It's
we'd go
true.
To bed crying and shouting and praising and rejoicing, just reading one little chapter.
Yes.
It's unreal.
Just his description of what happened when Christ died and descended into the lower parts of the earth and led
towel.
Captivity captive.
You'll need mm-hmm. it
yes.
for tears.
Oh. We haven't gotten it far. Oh.
We've given it away three times through the years, just recently, earlier this year, and another 100,000 went out. And I pray that everyone in the world will get to read
it's
Destined for the
book.
Throne by Paul Billheimer. Mm.
But I asked him that. I was reading the book, and like you said, I really got blessed. And I leaned over to Jack, and I said, honey, how many more years do you think we have before we'll be with the Lord? And I couldn't nail him down either.
All right, I'll tell you what. And first of all, I would never try to get you to do that because it's not scriptural. I know that it's wrong to set dates. But the times and the seasons,
yeah. mm-hmm.
the general times, Paul said in 2 Thessalonians, that day will not overtake you as a thief because you're not children of the darkness. Okay, if you were going to paint us a little scenario of the next few years, what would be some of the great events breaking upon the world scene that would lead up to the rapture of the church and then the coming again of the Lord?
The signs are abounding. In Daniel 12:4, he says, many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. Right at this moment, 80% of all scientists who've ever lived are alive. At the University of Liverpool, England, they have this new laser machine that can put 1 trillion holes in the head of a pin. And they can put all 39 volumes of Encyclopedia Britannica into those holes, and then, like a player piano, run it over this laser beam, and it will play back all the volumes of Britannica
on the head
off the head of a pin. They now are developing a new electronic system, wiring system. This comes out of Omni Science magazine, whereby they can put 6 million wires in one hair on your head for future electronics.
6 million in the size of a human hair.
Size of a human hair. Knowledge should be increased. Nahum chapter 2, verses 3 and 4, the chariot. Isaiah 31:5, men shall fly as birds, jets. It's just here everywhere. Jesus talked about all of the signs in Matthew 24, and he talked about that which was going to happen in space. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be dark, and the moon shall not give her light. The heavens shall shake, and everything is happening up above us right now. There are just so many things as we put it all together. What does it mean? It means that Russia is talking peace, but that's what's supposed to happen. And I mean, our officials are taken in by it, but when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction, 1 Thessalonians 5:3. We can't have an Antichrist until one comes saying, I will bring peace. That's how he comes to power.
Could you, Jan brought up a very interesting question the other night, which has troubled her, and that is, okay, if Antichrist is an actual human being that will actually be host to Satan himself, in other words, the devil enters into the physical person of the Antichrist, and he rises to power and makes this covenant with Israel. So what was your question
again?
I just, as
a thinking person living today in this earth, I know how people are so skeptical of everybody. You know, we look at Gorbachev and say, oh, he's a phony. You know, we look at everybody, oh, he's always, always, you know, oh, Bush, oh, he's weak. You know, everybody says something about something. And I just can't see the world today looking at a person
and giving that kind of allegiance.
I will literally bow down to an image of you. You know, and I say that until I look at footage of the Second World War and see them all going, Heil Hitler, you know, and that was in our lifetime. So I do understand it can happen. But what do you think, Dr. Van Impe, that he will be? Where will he come from? What will make him so wonderful that this world today of yuppies and yippies and all those that are so smart
pretty sophisticated
would actually
people.
Bow down to an image of a man? I mean, they don't even believe in anybody holy today. And on top of that, who would give him power to say to the Israelis, who have fought off everybody and their uncle right now and are winning and sitting over there just winning and smiling at the whole wide world, we're winning, that, okay, now you can rebuild your temple. I mean, they could rebuild it today if they really wanted to, you know, but they know it would start a holy war. But how do you think it will happen that one person could rise today with that kind of power?
First of all, it's not going to be a leader from Russia. It's going to be a leader from the 10 nation confederation.
Western Europe.
Western Europe. That may shock a lot of people, but it's going to come out of the Western democracies. And
which will be what countries?
Right now it's Benelux, that's the beginning of it. Belgium, Luxembourg, Holland, which is the Netherlands, West Germany, France, Italy, Denmark, England, Ireland, Greece, Spain, and Portugal. They're the 12.
Is there anybody over there that is even one bit powerful that you think the whole world would bow down to?
Number 13 would probably be Austria. And the Antichrist, of course, will be very, very anti-Semitic. And this isn't for the record, but isn't it strange about Waldheim, who was the head of the United Nations and is now known to have served in the Austrian or German army and was heading up one of the camps where they annihilated Jews.
What would make Israel ever look to him then for a peace pact?
Whoever it is, he's going to have the power of Satan within him. And he is going to, Jesus said, deceive even the elect if it were possible. It's not possible. But if he's that outgoing that he could even deceive the elect, those who are here at that time.
You know, what I have wondered, Jack, is what would happen to the world psyche if suddenly we had a real brush with nuclear devastation? I mean, it would scare the world so badly until if a strong political leader stood up and said, look, I have the answer. We'll never have to have this problem. You know, I don't know how the scenario is going to read, but I have a feeling that something pretty dramatic is going to happen on the world scene that is going to literally scare the world into casting their allegiance to. Have you ever thought of that kind of a plan?
I've always preached that when things look like they're going to break instantaneously, like Cuba a few years ago, the Bay of Pigs, I remember how people were frightened. I was in the midst of the crusade and people were scared to death. It could be at a time like that when this world leader comes to power. But you ask, how can all these intellectuals become involved? The New Age movement is loaded with intellectuals.
Right. You're right.
And on one of my programs not long ago, I said, I believe the New Age movement is the organization that will bring the Antichrist into power. Mm-hmm. Because in 2 Thessalonians 2, he says, that day shall not come except there come a falling away first. And what is that falling away? Verse 4, where a man proclaims himself as God, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. And Shirley MacLaine in the movie, she stood on the beach, said, I am God. And that's the philosophy of the New Age movement. Here we have Ramtha speaking through J.Z. Knight.
Who's that?
It's just a lady from Washington State who think she has, it's probably a 3,500-year-old demon speaking through her. Is that what it is?
Yes.
35,000-year-old or whatever.
And I missed her somehow.
Yeah Ramtha Dynasty. What's the actresses?
Linda Evans
is following him right now. These people will go to these seminars, pay $35 per evening. And Uri Geller is controlled by Lazarus, a spirit that speaks through him. Mm-hmm. And we've got all these spirits speaking through people. Now, that is the falling away that leads to the one who says, I am God, because 1 Timothy 4:1 says, the Holy Spirit, the good one, our wonderful Holy Spirit, speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits. Mm-hmm. So here is a woman, J.Z. Knight, who was originally in my denomination, who has fallen away, and three or four of these people who are allowing spirits to speak through them now were in different denominations who've left the Christian faith for these spirits, and in all of the philosophy behind it, they say, I am God. Mm-mm-mm. And that's what the Antichrist will say. And these are intellectuals.
I'd always thought of that falling away as being like some terrible declension within the church, and we just see whole churches kind of fall away, or great masses of Christians.
Well, the Lord put this all together in my mind a few weeks ago on the program, and I got excited.
I have a real strong witness in my spirit as you speak of that right now. We've seen all of this breaking, and you know what? A year ago, they went up on mountaintops around the world and began humming and calling in this new age and so forth.
Right.
I didn't know that some of these were at one time members of regular churches.
Even Aunt LaVey, the Church of Satan, according to Billy Zioli of Gospel Films, one half of the members of the Church of Satan are those who've turned from the Christian faith, who grew up in all of our denominations and left them. The four, Satanism. One
falling
half.
Away is here, then, isn't mm-hmm. it?
Mm-hmm. Amazing. You know, he brought up something else, too, honey. I don't know if I mentioned this when we were here the last time. The two things that Satan said to Eve in the garden, you shall not die, and you shall be as gods, mm-hmm. as God. Well, that's what the New Age movement is telling people. Reincarnation, you shall not die, and you are God. The two things that Satan said to mm-hmm. Eve is exactly what Satan is promising again those who are in the New Age movement. Reincarnation, not dying, and being as God. They feel they're God.
You know what's so frightening to me about this New Age thing is that people think it is so right.
Yes, they do.
They're talking about experiences like they've never had, and they're talking about it's the answer, and you know, and I feel connected in all these things that the church should have been offering the world.
That's sad, Jan, because there's an openness out there.
They are. It's the spirit within us reaching out for something mm-hmm. wonderful.
And the church refused to give any real spiritual
gifts
or experiences, so the devil sure
he'll give them.
Offered his counterfeits.
He's giving answers, false mm-hmm. answers, and that's what people want today. They want some answers about the hereafter. They really want to know what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. And here comes Shirley MacLaine with answers.
Yeah.
And
saying
they
you'll come back.
Exactly, mm-hmm. you know.
Do you believe those are demons that really talk through those people and are really giving them
definitely.
Some absolute
It can be
information?
One of two things. Either they're putting on an act, but if it is genuine, it's a demonic spirit speaking.
And demons certainly were around back in then, and they know things and events and times, and they can tell you what you did when you were 1 year old. They were around mm-hmm. then, too.
Well, sure.
But it's evil.
Angels and demons are eternal spirits. Mm-hmm. They do not die. Mm-hmm. Every spirit that was here in Christ's day mm-hmm. is still in
still
existence.
Here. Yes.
Right.
Yes.
This is something else the Lord gave me not long ago. When I saw it, I just couldn't believe it. Jan mentioned it a moment ago about Daniel's prayer being hindered. He said one in 20 days mm-hmm. did the Prince of Persia withstand me. Mm-hmm. Prince of Persia. Persia changed its name in 1932 to Iran. Okay. Mm-hmm. But then he says in the same chapter, I will send the Prince of Persia to fight. Who is the Prince of Persia that's mentioned there? Oh, I will send Michael, the archangel, to fight the Prince of Persia.
Yes.
All right? Michael, the archangel. The only other time he's mentioned after that in the New Testament is Revelation 12:7, where Michael and the archangels fought against the dragon, mm-hmm. and the dragon and his angels fought against Michael, the archangel.
Mm-hmm.
But when does it happen? When Persia is in the news. Because Ezekiel 38:5 says Persia, Ethiopia, Libya with them, all of them with shield and helmet, Gomer and all his bands, the house of Garma of the north quarters and his bands, many people with him. Persia marches with Rosh against Israel. Michael the archangel has always been the protectorate of Israel.
Israel.
And here he says, I will send Michael the archangel to fight the Prince of Persia. He's talking about the spirit that always controlled the leaders of Persia. Mm-hmm. And here, this last great scene is in the heavens when Michael the archangel is fighting the dragon. Mm. And that's during the tribulation hour when Rosh and Persia are marching against Israel.
He resisted him back in Daniel's time and will again at the end of time.
He says, I will send him to fight.
Yeah.
And it's never happened, and it happens during the tribulation
hour. Okay. What? Back to my original question. And I know we can't know this for sure, but I love to study the prophetic scriptures, and I love to know what's up ahead. Just sanctified guessing right now, what do you think will be some of the next great breaking news items on the world scene that will signal the next step toward the end of this age?
It's all happening right now. Every single sign. And Jesus did not say, when you see wars, look up. When you see famine, look up. He says, when you shall see all these things. Matthew 24:33. Then know that it's near, even at the door.
Jack.
I think the only thing that still has to happen is that number 13 has to join Common Market. And that's it. And then he knocks off three of them. And in the days of these ten, see, when one of the final three takes the reins and eliminates three, he shall subdue three, and we're back to ten. In the days of these ten shall the Lord God of heaven set up his kingdom, which shall never be destroyed, Daniel 2:44. I think that's about the only thing left.
Can I just ask one question, Paul, here? And I don't want to let it go. AIDS. He feels that AIDS is the pestilence, in the book of Revelation. And just in our Detroit news, just before we left home, there was a big article now that down in Haiti, it's become a tremendous epidemic among the heterosexuals that it's going to really reach proportions all over the world. Primarily, though,
because of bisexuality there.
Yes.
It's very common.
But you mentioned on our program, honey, and I wish that you bring that out, about the rider of the White Horse.
We're going to be offering our book on AIDS again on this network. We're going to be preaching about it in the next few weeks. Not this next week, but 2 or 3 weeks from now. And, of course, Revelation 6:8 tells about the multitudes who shall die, and it's through the beasts of the field. And I've got all this documentation in my book on AIDS by the greatest specialist in the world that it has come through the beasts of the field.
The AIDS epidemic? I heard that it began in Africa through the green monkey.
Right.
Yeah.
And there are some today who write me and send me materials by every scholar imaginable who tries to dispute that theory, and they say that they were manufactured in Maryland by commies and who are infiltrating the
The vaccine, you mean? The germ was created.
I hear all these things.
Oh, boy.
But I believe what these specialists say, which I recorded in my book, and my AIDS book is nothing but a compilation of about 1,000 of the best specialist reports internationally. And we offered it twice, and it's moved just like Israel's final Holocaust moved, and we're going to go back and offer it again.
What do you think that is, Doctor? Do you really think it's the pale horse? Or whatever it is, which one of the horses
death.
Is that?
The what?
Well, this is the first time where one out of four could be taken in death by the beast of the field, or that which was created through the beast of the field.
And that, what is that?
AIDS.
What scripture is that, I mean?
Revelation 6:8.
And it says, what does it say?
About the pale horse. It describes the fire and the various things that take them and the beasts of the field.
Read it from the living.
And then the fourth seal was broken, and I heard the fourth living being say, come. And now I saw a pale horse, and its rider's name was Death. And there followed after him another horse whose rider's name was Hell. And they were given control of 1/4 of the earth to kill with war and famine and disease and wild animals, the living says. But in the king, it must say the beasts of the
beasts of the field.
And now, we don't really aren't going to see a horse riding anywhere, obviously. So what does this mean to the people out there? It talks about horse riding. Now, what would someone tuning in tonight for the first time?
A pale horse.
You're not going to see a pale horse riding anywhere.
Yeah, the Greek there is a chloros, which is a green, sickly color.
It just means that's what you'll see on the face of the earth.
Because there's the rider of the red horse, and the rider on the black horse, and the red horse talks about war, the black horse talks about famine and pestilence, and then the pale horse talks about disease. Mm-hmm. But the one rider on the horse will be the genuine one, and that's the one on the white horse, and that's the Antichrist in chapter 6, and the Lord Jesus Christ in Revelation 19:11.
Mm-hmm. Okay. A lot of this goes over our heads to some extent, Jack, because not everybody is able to dig in as you have and really study these scriptures. So in that sense, we appreciate the hard work that you've done. But, you know, what about that guy out there that says, ah, so what? So what will be, will be. So the big horn is going to eat up the little horn. So this, so that, so... Mm-hmm. It, que sera, sera. Whatever will be, and I'll just wait it out and we'll see what happens, and so what? So what? What's the danger of that?
Of being lost eternally.
You really believe that? That
definitely.
What will cause that person out there who doesn't really believe all of this that we're talking about, that the Bible's... You know, how can we convince that guy out there that he's really in a very dangerous position or condition?
Well, in 2 Thessalonians 2:12, it says that they all might be damned who believe not the truth. And in that chapter, he's talking about the falling away, this world leader calling himself God, and the things we've discussed tonight. See?
Okay. What does it mean to be damned? What is that writer there talking about?
Well, it's the same thing Jesus talked about in Mark 16:16. He that believeth not shall be damned. And that's talking about eternal hell, the lake of fire.
Do you believe that's literal? Do you believe that people who do not believe this word and accept the Christ of this word will literally... Would God really let somebody burn in literal flames of hell forever and ever and ever?
I believe the Bible. And I was on a program in Philadelphia, Channel 10, debating two liberal ministers. And I love to debate liberal ministers. And he got on the air and made the first statement. He said, I no longer preach the Pauline epistles, because Paul is a hellfire judgment minister. And he said, my people don't need to hear that after working 40 hours. He said, I just preach the four gospels, the loving, tender Jesus. He would never talk about damnation, never talk about judgment. The moderator gave it to me, and I said to the liberal minister, could I see your Bible for a moment? He said, what for? I said, I just want to see it. And I thumbed through. I said, you know what? This is the same as mine. He said, of course it is. So I want to tell you something. I said, the four-letter word, H-E-L-L, is found 24 times in the New Testament. I said, Luke, who wrote the book of Acts, mentioned it twice, Acts 2:27, 2:31. I said, Peter mentioned it once, 2 Peter 2:4. James mentioned it once, chapter 3, verse 6. John, who wrote the Gospel of John, also wrote the book of Revelation, mentioned it three times, Revelation 6:8, 2013, 2014. I said, that's seven times. Jesus mentioned it the other 17 times. I said, guess what? Paul never mentioned it once. I said, you got the wrong hero. You better quit preaching Jesus to your people. Quit preaching the four gospels, because Christ was the most powerful judgment preacher ever in history. And Paul described it, but never used the actual term hell. However, if we use the other expressions Paul mentioned, such as in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God, 2 Thessalonians 1:8. We have a total of 162 references on the subject, not including the other terms, abyss and bottomless pit, etc. So we have to believe the Bible. He that believeth on Christ is not condemned. He that believeth not is condemned already. John 3:18.
But I'm sure this is hard for maybe people who have never had any religious teaching or training of any kind, or maybe have come from the Middle East where they've been brought up in the Muslim faith, or the Far East where they've brought up in the Buddhist faith or the Shinto religion. Mm-hmm. How can we be so egotistical as to believe that our religion is the only possible way for a man to get to heaven?
Because all scripture is given by inspiration of God. 2 Timothy 3:16, holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost, 2 Peter 1:20. The Holy Spirit wrote that book. And it was the Holy Spirit who said to Acts 4:12, through Luke, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved, Acts 4:12. That's the name of Jesus. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, every tongue should confess. Romans, the 10th chapter. I could go back to Noah's day. There were only 8 people alive. Had everyone heard the gospel?
Yes.
Everyone
yes.
knew the way from Noah's day onward, and all these groups drifted, fell away from what they heard after coming out of the ark. Mm-hmm. So everybody did have a chance then. And of course, yeah. they're going to have another chance because the gospel of the kingdom shall be preached all the world for a witness unto all nations, Matthew 24:14.
Mm-hmm. You know, you've never heard anybody say why Noah just hated those people by telling them if they didn't get on board, they would drown. Why, can you believe Noah just hated those people? That is love, my friend, to warn you mm-hmm. of a doom that is coming. Hell was not prepared for you. It was prepared for the devil and his angels. That mm-hmm. scripture. That flood was not prepared for those people. It was to cleanse the earth. And if they'd have gotten on board, they would have been saved. Mm-hmm. Have you ever thought it was horror when your parents told you, baby, don't run out in the street because you might die if a car hits you? That's not hate. That's love. Jesus warning us and telling us not to go to those places. Noah warning those precious people, get on board and you won't die. And he did for how many years? 120 years or something. Only had 8 converts. Mm-hmm. But those were saved from the watery death. Yeah. And Jesus' love is warning you to not go to hell. Mm-hmm. He's preparing heaven for you, really. Hell is for the devil and his angels.
Go ahead, Jack. You had a thought right here. But
God loves everybody. God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved, John 3:17. Romans 8:32 says, God spared not his own Son. That's how much he loved you. Sin had to be punished. So God said, I'll send my Son, and he'll take your place. You ever wonder why Jesus said in Matthew 27:46, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? My God, why have you forsaken me? God spared not his Son. During those 3 hours when Christ bore your sin, adultery, fornication, homosexuality, lying, drunkenness, drug addiction, gossip, hatred, murder, all on Jesus. His Father, a holy God, so hated sin, heaped on Jesus that he wouldn't even look at his Son for those hours. God spared not his Son, that you might be spared eternally if you let this Jesus into your heart.
Amen. Jack, we have just a few minutes. Why don't you just invite those who have heard this word and are ready to come right now?
The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved, Romans 10:30. Whosoever? Whosoever. He died for all. There's one God and one mediator between God and men. It's the man, Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all, for you. If you will look to the cross tonight and ask Jesus Christ to cleanse you through his shed blood, he'll do it. The blood of Jesus, God's Son, cleanseth from all sin. I don't care what you've done. He'll cleanse you. Would you look at me right now and pray this prayer from your heart? Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
I know I'm a sinner.
I know I'm a sinner.
You died for me.
You died for me.
Shedding your blood.
Shedding your blood.
To wash and cleanse me.
To wash and cleanse me.
You took my sin.
You took my sin.
Your Father would not spare you during those hours.
Father would not spare you in those hours.
Forgive me.
Forgive me.
And wash me.
And wash me.
Save me now.
Save me now.
In your name I pray.
In your name I pray.
Amen.
Many, I'm sure, prayed with you just then, Jack. And if you did, God's greatest miracle is yours, and we always love to have you call our prayer partners and tell us, because we'll send you a Bible if you need one, and we'll ask for it. Two quick things, Jack. First of all, I know a lot of folks are going to want to get in touch with you, find out about your books. We'll get you an address in just a minute, so please don't write to us for Brother Van Impey's book. We don't have them, but we'll get you an address that you can write to him, and he'll give you. There it is, Troy, Michigan. There will be many who heard us tonight, Jack, who are still unconvinced. They're not going to receive it. They're not going to buy any of this. There will come something in the world, be it the rapture of the church, be it the invasion of Russia into, there will come some world cataclysmic event that will finally convince even the worst skeptic that what we're talking about is true, it's real, and there will come a point in time where you will believe, friend. What could you say to those people who aren't going to buy this tonight, Jack, but the day's going to come when they're going to know that what you and I and we talked about tonight is true and is real? Is there any word you can give them?
Well, I like 2 Peter 3:9. The Lord is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish. Mm-hmm. And he gives us chance after chance after chance. But Paul, it's sad to say that even when Christ rules and reigns with a rod of iron for 1,000 years, Revelation 19, that at the end of the 1,000 years, many rebel and turn against
even
him again.
Then,
even
yes.
then. Even when God's here, mm-hmm. they'll do it. So yeah. if they won't listen when he's here, they're not going to listen to us.
But for some who will be convinced, even at some future date, what can they do at that moment if there's still time? I guess just what? Fall on their knees and ask
Whosoever
God
shall
then.
Call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Whenever.
Wherever you are, just call him.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen. Ooh, what an interesting evening.
And don't take the mark of the beast.
Oh. Yes.
That's another subject.
That's another whole evening, actually, and maybe we can get into that next time.
We're so glad you've been with us for Praise the Lord. If you'd like an audio visit of Praise the Lord, please write and ask for program 0530-89. That's 0530-89. The tapes will be sent for your love gift to the Praise the Lord program. TBN has a worldwide ministry. We need your love gifts, large or small, to help keep the gospel of Jesus Christ going around the world. So write today, Praise the Lord, P.O. Box A, Santana, California, 92711. Or in Canada, write TBN, P.O. Box 23517, Vancouver, AMF, Vancouver, British Columbia, B7B 1W2. If you would like to contact guests or musicians for their tapes, books, or albums, please write us at TBN and we will forward your correspondence. If you haven't asked Christ into your life, call up your partner now and pray to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord. Now, until next time, remember to praise the Lord.
This program was brought to you by the prayers and contributions of our faithful partners throughout the United States of America.